Good morning and welcome to St. John United Church of Christ. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you're welcome here. Just a few announcements before we begin this morning. First, if you're on Facebook, please be sure to comment as you're watching so we know that you are there. With regards to resuming the building usage, Consistory has decided to begin allowing in-person meetings for boards and committees, and this includes Narcotics Anonymous. Of course, with physical distancing and masks, beginning in July, we've decided to wait until about mid to the end of July to see what's happening with the economic reopening in Ohio and the case rate, and more specifically the case rate in Defiance County, before we make a final decision as to when we will actually resume in-person worship. And lastly, we had a Red Cross blood drive this week, and I just want to give thanks to everyone who participated in it. It was the most successful drive we have had to date. Prior to this one, the most we ever had were 29 donations, and we actually had 39 people come to donate, six of whom were unable to donate, but we had 33 people who were accepted, with four of those 33 actually doing a double donation, so we had 37 donations, so that is a record for us. So thanks again for all who participated in that blood drive. So now let us gather our hearts and our minds in a spirit of worship as Sally plays for us some music on the organ. Thank you. Let us join together in centering our hearts in worship. Some of us are hurting, some of us are smarting. All are welcome in this place. Some of us are very young, some of us are getting old.
All are welcome in this place.
Some of us have hearts of gladness, some of us are filled with grief.
All are welcome in this place.
The strong and the weak, the faithful and the doubter, the saint and sinner, the regular and visitor.
All are welcome in this place.
Will you join with me in calling upon God? Welcoming God, we come to you as we often do, knowing that you are waiting with open arms, ready to welcome us, your family, here in this place. Lord, may we never take this for granted. Try harder to live up to your gracious welcome, accept your love, and in turn, offer that same love and welcome to all whom we meet. Amen. I think that's a continuation from last week. I forgot to change the slide. And so now a message for the young and the young at heart. Do you like cold water? I mean, I do. I keep a pitcher of water here at the church so that I can have cold water whenever I need it or want it. Like, I have 2 bottles at home as well that I keep in the fridge because I like cold water. And water is very important to human beings. In fact, did you know that your body is made up of 50 to 60% water? And babies are almost 80% water. Maybe that's why they're so squishy. So what happens to you when it's really hot outside? I mean, if you're like me, you sweat a lot. And sweating is the way God made our bodies so that they would be able to cool off a little bit. But if your body's around 50% water, what do you think happens if you really sweat a lot? You can lose a lot of that water that's part of your body. You can become what's called dehydrated, which can cause you to become really sick. And if you get too dehydrated, you could even die if you don't replace the water that you're losing through sweating. So imagine if you were traveling across the desert or just outside on a very hot, sunny day. Wouldn't a cold cup of water be really nice? In the gospel lesson from Matthew that we will hear later today, Jesus was giving his disciples some last-minute instructions before they were going to go out and teach people about God, just as Jesus had been doing. Disciples would be traveling in a very dry and sunny place on foot, and they would likely be very thirsty when they got where they were going. Now, Jesus told his disciples that people who would even offer a cup of cold water to someone would be like giving him a cup of cold water. Giving people what they need is a way for us to show hospitality. And when we show hospitality to one another, we're showing hospitality to Jesus. Now here in Defiance, there are several food pantries, including a very small one that we just started at this church. There's also a homeless shelter called the Path Center. There's a shelter for women who are trying to escape abusive relationships. It's called the House of Ruth. There's a Backpack Buddies program housed here at the church that provides food for students who may not have enough to eat at home. And then there's a general help organization that's called Ravens Care, and they help with utilities and rent and just finding the right resources for people who come to them in need. And of course, there are many, many other churches and organizations that provide meals and clothing and all sorts of other services. Jesus really knew the importance of helping other people and the importance of accepting help when you really need it. And it's really what he calls us to do as his followers, to provide help and to accept help when we need it. So let's pray. Loving and compassionate God, we are so grateful in this hot summer to be in a place where water is plentiful. We give you thanks for the example and the teachings that we have in Jesus Christ, your Son, how he came to earth as you, embodying you, to show us how to live and love one another and how to live and love your creation. So help us, God, go out into the world and be your living presence, the presence of Christ within us, and let it shine upon others, that we might be your living presence where it's most needed. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. And now let us enter a time of meditation as Sally once again plays for us. It's the time in our worship service where we lift any special joys or concerns that you may have in your life or the life of those you love and care for. You can text them to me at 248-515-5522, or you can post them on our Facebook feed, and Eric will relay those to me. Sometimes texts don't come through until after the service is over, so I apologize for that. But will continue to hold your prayers in my heart. A couple of prayers that I have this morning. One is for Ann Lyman, who is Linda Fetter's mother, who is 100 years old and was recently hospitalized, but I understand now she's home. So if you could lift her up, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And also I lift up Wayne Schaefer, who had surgery on Wednesday and is recovering. He was supposed to come home either yesterday or today. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
I'd also like to lift up prayers for Christy and Jordan Plant as Christy nears her due date, that they may have an uneventful delivery. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
So let us gather all these prayers together with those that we still hold within the depths of our hearts, and lift them up to God in a few moments of silence. God of welcome, we thank you that you are always ready, waiting to welcome us, always waiting to spend time with us and hear what we want to bring to you in prayer. This prayer could be an endless list, and there will be situations missed and and people escaping our attention. But we know that you are able to see beyond our limited memories and hold all that pains creation with us and for us. We are so consumed by the effects of a virus that many situations have gone unnoticed. We pray now for those in our world who feel forgotten, for refugees in camps not only worried about when their lives might take a better turn, but now also fearful of this invisible danger, for men, women, and children behind closed doors living with danger and torment at the hands of people who profess to love them, for people living with life-threatening conditions, relying on reduced levels of care, fearful of catching this virus as they fear their treatment will be limited. For those in the background within caregiving services, the cleaners, the janitorial staff, the administrators and managers, doing what is needed to ensure hospitals and care homes run smoothly and safely. For places of conflict, where with attention elsewhere dangers are increased and tensions raised, and where deaths continue unheeded. For people protesting while we are in the middle of the pandemic, protesting so that their voices will be heard and the names of the dead remembered. So many places, so many concerns. Lord, we thank you that we can bring them to you as we pray in the way that Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, both now and forever. Amen. Well, we continue to do the work of the church and hope that at this time you'll take a few moments to prepare an envelope to send in your gift or connect with our Tithely account as shown on the screen here, or consider going to your bank to set up online giving through them. Jesus said, Truly I tell you, those who offer a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple will not lose their reward. So, beloved, let us offer to God the gifts of our lives and our labor. join together with me in the dedication of these gifts. Lord, we bring to you our offerings, our money, our time, and ourselves, not as payment for something given, but out of adoration and thanksgiving for all we have received. Take what we offer and who we are. Bless them to the work of this church in your kingdom. Amen. Will you join me in prayer? Loving God, as we hear your word this day, send your spirit to equip and inspire us, that your grace-filled hospitality may be the center of our lives. Amen. The first reading this morning is taken from Psalm 13, and I'll be reading from the Common English Bible. How long will you forget me, Lord? Forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long will I be left to my own wits, agony filling my heart? Daily? How long will my enemy keep defeating me? Look at me, answer me, Lord my God. Restore sight to my eyes. Otherwise I'll sleep the sleep of death, and my enemy will say, I won. My foes will rejoice over my downfall. But I have trusted in your faithful love. My heart will rejoice in your salvation. Yes, I will sing to the Lord because he has been good to me. And our second reading is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, verses 40 through 42. And again, I'll be reading from the Common English Bible. Those who receive you are also receiving me, and those who receive me are receiving the one who sent me. Those who receive a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. Those who receive a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. I assure you that everybody who gives even a cup of cold water to these little ones, because they are my disciples, will certainly be rewarded. The Holy Spirit breathes into us these words. Now, a former coworker and a friend of mine is an avid practitioner of yoga, and she often signs her emails with Namaste, which is a traditional Hindu greeting in India. And it comes from an ancient language called Sanskrit, and its literal interpretation is, I bow to the divine in you. Now, given that she was born and raised as a Christian in the Pentecostal tradition, and knowing that her faith is still an integral part of her life, I was kind of curious as to why she used a Hindu greeting in closing her emails. In researching the term, I found that for those in the West, especially in the United States, Namaste is both a greeting and a farewell that is done in salutation of the God that resides within each of us, as well as an acknowledgement that there is a spirit that connects all of us in an essential and universal way. Now, one writer posted on a website that when she asked her yoga instructor what Namaste meant, he told her, knowing that she was Christian, that Namaste means the Christ in me recognizes and honors the Christ in you. The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 3:16, do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? And in Romans 8:11, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit which dwells in you. So as believers in Jesus Christ, God's Holy Spirit dwells within us. Namaste, a holy welcome. In the Gospel of Matthew that we heard today, Jesus was completing his instructions to his disciples about their mission in the world. And it's the conclusion of the passages that we've been hearing the last couple of weeks. And if you remember, Jesus had been instructing the disciples about how they were to go out among the people, spreading the good news, curing the sick, raising the dead, cleansing those with skin diseases, and casting out demons. And Jesus had warned them about how they might be treated, how they might be rejected by some and persecuted by others for doing what was right. And Jesus offered them encouragement while telling them of the level of commitment that was necessary to do exactly what he was teaching them to do. But he also told them that they should not be afraid, because God cared for them, and God cared for those that they were reaching out to. So up until this point in the gospel story in Matthew, the disciples had simply been followers of Jesus, going with him from place to place, watching him, listening to him, and learning. Jesus had been preparing them to continue the work he was doing, work of being providers of God's love rather than simply consumers. Work that, you know, we're also called to do. Now, it isn't something to be done to receive a reward or earn a ticket to heaven, because we're already assured of that through the death and the resurrection of Jesus. Rather, it is work that we are called to do in acknowledgement of the grace and the love that has been already given freely to us. We are called to respond to the love and the grace that we have received by returning it back to those out in the world around us. We are to be the living presence of God in Christ in the world for others. For Jesus said, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me." When others welcome us, they welcome Christ. They welcome God into their lives, the Spirit that dwells within each of us. Namaste, a holy welcome. Now, a number of years ago, Caldwell, one of my favorite still speaking writers, wrote a devotional for the UCC based on 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11. And that selection reads like this: "The end of all things is near. Therefore, be serious and discipline yourselves for the sake of your prayers. Above all, maintain constant love for one another, for love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Jesus Christ. To him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen." And that was from the New Revised Standard Version. But for Caldwell, the beginning of verse 11 really leapt off the page. "Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God." Caldwell wrote, "When I read this line, I frantically flipped through the book looking for the part where Peter was talking only about how to act in worship. Turns out, Peter was talking about all the time. He says that it's our job to try to have everything that comes out of our mouths be something that God would say. Everything." Now think about that for a moment. If we would talk like God would talk, if we would act like God would act, what would happen? Do you think people would see God within us? If we treated people as if God is in them, if we honored God within them, what would happen? We would be welcoming God into our life, and they would be welcoming God into theirs. Namaste, a holy welcome. In Psalm 13, the psalmist speaks from a place of exile, desolation, and abandonment. The psalmist is surrounded by an enemy, whether that would be an invader or death itself. And Martin Luther called the mood of the prayer the state in which hope despairs and yet despair hopes at the same time. Well, during this time of the coronavirus and the resurgence of the Black Lives Matter movement, after the murder of George Floyd revealed to the world a disturbing pattern that has existed for far too long without being acknowledged by most of us, my thoughts turned to this psalm. How long, O Lord, how long have you forgotten? And the psalm is a prayer to God, a petition that proclaims this sense of abandonment, anxiety, and inner turmoil, the same sorts of feelings that these sorts of events bring out. And yet it ends in a word of hope. Now in Matthew 10, Jesus had forewarned the disciples that they might experience such feelings as they went about doing the work that had been given them to do. But they were to persist. When the people welcomed them, they welcomed him, whether they were being prophetic or righteous. And whoever gave the little ones, the people who were just becoming awakened to the invitation of Christ, or to the disciples, a cup of cold water, they would find life. When Jesus talked about prophets in our message from Matthew today, it was not in terms of what we think of today when we hear those words. And prophets were not fortune tellers or those who predicted the end of the world. A prophet in the biblical sense is one who brings attention to the ways in which the people have strayed from God's intention for creation. Often in the Bible, a prophet is someone who speaks truth to power, who stands up to the societal and religious views and practices that run contrary to God's will for the world. And when you read from the prophetic texts in the Bible, you'll find the prophets speaking for God, calling for the people to remember the widows, the orphans, the imprisoned, and the oppressed. Prophets in the Bible speak the word of God before the people. They speak as God would speak to those actions, to those whose actions deny the presence of God in others, to those whose actions cause oppression of others, to those who imprison unfairly, to those who ignore the widows and the orphans. Those who receive a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. In the letter to the Ephesians, Paul wrote, "The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ." That's Ephesians 4, 11 through 13. And this, my friends, is the work that we are called to do out of response to God's grace and love. As Paul said, some are called to be prophets. And when we are welcomed as prophets, we bring God's presence into the lives of others, and they welcome God's presence in our lives. And together we build up the body of Christ. Namaste, a holy welcome. But not all of us are called to be prophets to stand up and challenge others to examine their lives or to stand up to the powers that be. The world also needs people who work behind the scenes, providing support, providing comfort, providing encouragement. People who support the prophets and people who simply live their lives as if they were always, always in the presence of God. People whose way of life shows them truly to be righteous people. Why some good friends who are missionaries from the U.S., living in Germany, evangelists, really, people who simply want others to come to know Christ as they know Christ. And my friends, you know, they're not in your face about faith. I mean, if you bring up the topic of faith, sure, they'll be open to discussion. However, mostly they simply pray for those people they meet that they might be open to the Holy Spirit, that they might turn to God in Jesus Christ. Now, I don't necessarily understand theologically what believing in Christ means in the same way that they do. But my friends have this real presence about them, a sense of contentedness and groundedness and humility. I mean, they're genuinely just lovely, nice people. And when I think about it, getting to know them, well, it's a lot like getting to know God. I find them to be patient, caring, and committed to the call that, that they feel God has placed in their lives. Those who receive a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And the reward of the righteous is being in the presence of God. Those who welcome the righteous receive the presence of the righteous in their midst, and they welcome God. Namaste, a holy welcome. Well, as I mentioned in the message for the young and young at heart, I like cold water, especially in the heat of the summer. So I also keep a couple of refillable glass bottles in my fridge at home. And I can only imagine how cherished cold water is in the area of the Middle East where Jesus lived and worked. I mean, during the summer there, that area of the world averages 13 hours of sunshine per day with little cloud cover or rain. So imagine being a traveling teacher or a prophet like Jesus or the disciples, walking long distance between towns through a dry and dusty landscape. What must it be like to receive a cup of cold water there? Don't you think you'd be extremely thankful for a person giving you a cup of cold water? Wouldn't that cold water make you feel so much welcome? Would it not be like finding God in that person? And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. Our God is a welcoming God. As followers of Jesus Christ, we are called to be as God in the world, to continue the work that Jesus had begun, offering a holy welcome. As the psalmist ended their prayer, "But I have trusted in your faithful love. My heart will rejoice in your salvation. Yes, I will sing to the Lord because he has been good to me." In the words of Martin Luther King Jr., "How long? Not long, because our God is marching on. May we find that when we offer a cup of cold water to the little ones, we welcome Jesus into our lives. We welcome God into our life. And that is the promised reward that we have. God in our midst, God within us. Welcoming God's presence, Jesus' presence in one another. Namaste, a holy welcome."
Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to pray together with me the prayer in the time of the pandemic. May we who are merely inconvenienced remember those whose lives are at stake. May we who have no risk factors remember those who are vulnerable. May we who have the luxury of working from home remember those who must choose between preserving their health or making their rent, or must choose between returning to work or forfeiting their job without unemployment benefits. May we who have family to care for our children when we return to work remember those who can't return to work because they have no one to care for their children. May we who have to cancel our vacations remember those who lost their jobs in the tourism industry. May we who are losing money in the tumult of the economic market remember those whose daily life depends on the next paycheck. May we who settle in for a quarantine at home remember those who have no home. As fear grips our country, let us choose love. During this time when we cannot physically wrap our arms around each other, let us yet find ways to be the living embrace of God to our neighbors, so everyone can live and breathe. Amen. And now I want to celebrate in song as we listen to and watch First Plymouth Church in Lincoln, Nebraska.
Thank you.
God of design and creation's manufacturer,
Jesus,
purifier and water of life, Spirit, sustainer and the world's preservation agent, before you we gather, from you we take, away with you we go. Taking up the cause as you demand,
we go to serve your world.
Our worship has ended, now our service begins.